Little boy Hayoma living his happy life with his older siblings, one day his brother asked him to show him how they deal with spirits, as they are some kind of spirit hunters. But when Hayoma get to the location, the only sound that can be heard is the disgusting and slimy one of blood gushing from a body. A younger Hayoma has before him the terrifying sight of his brother and sister dying, bleeding to death while impaled, but even in these conditions they still find the strength to save him from ending up with the same fate as them. Now older Hayoma is after the Marabito, beings that come from a dimension called the spirit world and occasionally stumble into their world. Although they are spiritual beings, they have the ability to possess objects in order to obtain a physical form, and in that state they are usually called Tsukumagami. Hayoma is part of one of the three clans of Seinom and Kanato family's young leader. The Kanato family has been working with the government in dealing with Tsukumagami, working alongside the police. Sohei Kanato seals a Tsukumagami, like the one Hayoma faced before, whose spirit's physical form came from a coin. Zohei is Hayoma's grandfather, a proud one about his grandson doing the same kind of work as him, and upon the police being worried about seeing Hayoma chasing a Tsukumagami earlier, Zohei reassures them that his grandson is just like him and they get things done peacefully with conversations. Right after we see Hayoma punching one through the wall before sealing it, Hayoma explains to an angry and disappointed grandfather why he had to kill the Tsukumagami. His opponent had only been a Tsukumagami for a short period of time and he had not yet mastered the art of transforming himself into a human being nor the art of handling his own body. So before any damage could be done, Hayoma made the first move and killed him. Zohei still disapproves of his actions, telling him that the problem is that he always rushes in without a second thought every single time. When Marabito are spirited away into their world, they are confused, and when they change into Tsukumagami, how they deal with the change varies. Although there are evil spirits, there are also spirits that merely want to go home. Their job as members of the Seinom clan is to listen to them and guide them accordingly. Hayoma's rage towards the Tsukumagami comes from the evil one that killed his siblings, making him believe that it's best to kill them all right away than find out later that they are evil spirits. Among the Tsukumagami there are the exceptions, Tsukumagami who get some degree of freedom in exchange for following some conditions. Zohei is friends with some spirits like that, and they live as a family with other Tsukumagami and a human master. As a punishment for his behavior, Hayoma will have to live with the exceptions family under the guise of being their chaperone, or else he will be disowned from the Seinom clan. Upon his arrival at the family's house, Hayoma is greeted by the exceptions Hayori and Kushige while their master is at school, and all of the other Tsukumagami arrive shortly after. Hayoma expresses his hate for the Tsukumagami for deceiving humans, and if his goal was to intimidate them, he fails as everyone looks at him in amusement and Nagi even laughs. The mood only gets grim when Hayoma implies that they are probably taking advantage of their master Boten Nagatsuki, getting into a fight with Nagi. While Hayoma and Nagi fight, none of the other Tsukumagami get in their way, only watching it from the side. The only thing that makes them break the fight is a message received by Yu from Boten, saying that she will be skipping the rest of classes and is heading home, making all Tsukumagami scared and trying to find a way to quickly stop the two boys before their master gets home. They plan to hold them both down, but in the end only Hayoma was the target of punches and hits from the others. Boten gets home to Hayoma on the floor full of bruises and surrounded by the Tsukumagami, disapproving of their behavior. She seems to be highly respected by the spirits, who all look down in shame, except for Nagi, who nervously laughs but clearly holds a lot of respect and love for the girl. And so their life with a new member begins. Boten apologizes to Hayoma about the fight that happened before she got home, a fight that Hayoma takes full responsibility for. He will be staying with her and the Tsukumagami for a year, and the information that she got previously was that he wanted to learn more about the spiritual beings. Hayoma underestimates Boten, thinking that she doesn't have enough grit to command a group of 6 Tsukumagami. But she is the same girl who currently has Nagi tied upside down outside as a punishment. Hayoma is part of the Seinom clan, and as he explains it to Boten, the Seinom are humans empowered by Sinomaki, the guardian god of the border between the lands of the living and the dead. They are like the police of the Tsukumagami world, and their job is to seal those spirits. With this context, Hayoma thinks that they are untenable and a breed of monsters that shouldn't be treated like family. Boten gets angry at his insults towards her family and even ponders about making him leave the house, but ultimately gives him 3 days to change his ways of thinking. If Hayoma leaves earlier than his grandfather expects him to, he will become an ex-Seinom, Nagi sees usefulness in Hayama and invites him to hang out with him for some time. They will be hunting down a rogue Tsukumagami to seal it, which shows Hayama that the six spirits part of Boten's family are different from the ones he is used to hunting down. Nagi's deal is that if Hayama helps him with his job or does it for him, he will tell Boten that Hayama has been a decent guy. For the sixth Tsukumagami, this is a dirty business as it makes other Tsukumagami groups in the Land of the Living hate them and shun them, but all they have ever wanted was to be with Boten, so they do it for her. On the way home after sealing the rogue Tsukumagami, Hayama tells his motivation to get through this. His siblings were killed by a paper umbrella Tsukumagami that it's still alive to this day, but for some reason he can't access any information about it. If he becomes the head of the Seinome, he might be able to get a lead on him. Hayama is so determined to reach his goal that he has imposed a signature method, so all Tsukumagami can decide among themselves if they support him or not. If he earns the approval of all of them before the 3-day deadline, he'll be able to stay, and he already has Nagi's signature on the paper. Hayama joins Kagami and Suzuri for a job which doesn't go as well as planned. Suzuri keeps approaching people to make friends and Kagami stop to eat, making Hayama angry. Hayama doesn't understand why the Tsukumagami join Boten for breakfast and dinner when they have to need to eat, and why they waste time and money to act like humans. Kagami gets sad and explains to him that they just want to know what it's like to eat and pick out nice outfits and enjoy things the way that Boten and people do. The three of them visit a Tsukumagami, and this time it isn't to seal it but to do an evaluation. Suzuri questions her as to why she wants to live on their side, to which she tells him that she feels safe there and there is a nostalgic feeling in that world. Suzuri believes that it is a perfectly suitable reason to remain. And Kagami proceeds to check the Tsukumagami for a history of using her transformation powers for evil, using the Shoyokyo, a mirror that reveals the truth. After Kagami finished the Shoyokyo, everything checked out and the Tsukumagami passed the evaluation. However, upon hearing about the Nagatsuki household, something in her shifted and the Tsukumagami attacked Suzuri, cutting him in half. And before Kagami could be attacked as well, she was saved by Hayama. Before Hayama seals the Tsukumagami away, she cries and talks about why she is so scared of the Nagatsuki household, about how they hunt their own kind. Suzuri's body starts regenerating and coming back into one piece, using his special power to avoid being killed. He doesn't seem to be particularly surprised that their infamy follows them, and reassures her that they only came to her for an evaluation. Despite all of this, everything ends well and Kagami tells Hayama that she will still get her special exception. It seems that Hayama already gained the likes and trust of Nagi, Suzuri, and Kagami, and they even make him company while he works out outside. Now he only needs to conquer the hearts of Kushige, Hayori, and Yu. Boten approaches Hayama in the bathroom to thank him for saving Kagami from the Tsukumagami and hints towards them forgetting about the signature method and letting him stay with them regardless, an offer that Hayama refuses. Outside the bathroom, listening to their conversation is Yu, the Tsukumagami who is warier of Hayama and the one that will be harder to get to. The last time we saw the signatures on the paper, all of the Tsukumagami had signed it except her. In conversations with Kagami and Suzuri, Nagi tells them that Hayoma's biggest obstacle will be Yu, as she is already usually cold, but he also didn't leave a good first impression on her. It totally doesn't help that Hayama was going on a mission with her and got there late when the job was already done. Yu despises Hayama because of the hatred and disgust that he carries towards Tsukumagami and for making Boten cry with his insults towards them. There are only two ways for him to make her sign the paper. The first one is to give up, the second one is to make her yield and force her to sign. Their fight catches the attention of Tsukumagami, who have the desire to kill the Nagatsuki Tsukumagami, and the attention of Nagi, Suzuri, and Kagami, who end their mission to go get Hayama out of trouble. Despite his hatred for the beings, Hayama refuses to fight back. He was sent to the Nagatsuki house to change his views on the Tsukumagami, and after 2 days of being with them and joining in on their missions, he feels like there's something different about them. Hayori talks on the phone with Zohei, telling him about his grandson's progress, even though it will all be meaningless if he can't get through the third day. But for a moment their conversation gets mysterious as Hayori asks him if he is sure about managed to get through the day and accept the arrangements, which would mean something that we don't get to know. Zohei tells her that maybe that's what they both need to do. Since Hayama refuses to fight back, Yu asks if he will be giving up and leaving. But he is confident that they still have half a day left to get acquainted, leaving Yu a little bit dumbfounded. Still, Hyoma tells her that her reaction was very similar to a human one when someone close to them is offended, and he asks her if she likes Boden. Surprisingly, this statement leaves Yu blushing, and in a panic she throws her hairpin weapon at Hyoma. Both the group of Tsukumagami that are after the Nagatsuki group and Nagi make it at the same time to the place where Yu and Hyoma are. The Tsukumagami enter a fight with Yu, Nagi, Suzuri and Kagami, but first they plan on attacking and killing Hyoma, who is stuck on Yu's ability. Our group of Tsukumagami do everything in their power to protect Hyoma, but surprisingly he manages to force his way out of the cocoon from Yu's ability, proving that he is no ordinary person, and he proceeds to destroy the Tsukumagami, triggered by the knowledge that they have killed humans before. This rage that Hyoma showcased when he killed all of the Tsukumagami that wanted to cause trouble with the group, all the while with a sinister smile on his face, was the darkness that Zohei talked about. Despite this, Hayori looks at him and believes that signs of change are beginning to appear and that his warped mind can still be corrected. Hyoma is also their hope for Boten to be saved. In a flashback of Zohei holding a newborn Boten in front of the six Tsukumagami that are now part of her family, he explains that she stands on the borderline and will live a life of hurt from then on, but despite that he wants her to find happiness like other humans do, Zohei trusts the Tsukumagami to know what to do regarding that. This explains why he sent Hyoma to their house so he could change their behavior towards the Tsukumagami beings. Hyoma checks the signatures paper that will dictate if he gets to stay at the Nagatsuki house, with Yu being the harder one to convince to sign the paper. But there it is. At the very bottom of the page is Yu's signature, meaning that Hyoma will get to keep living with the Nagatsuki family and won't be kicked out of his clan by his grandfather. Even though Hyoma feels a connection between the six Tsukumagami and Boten, he is not yet convinced that the Tsukumagami being can be trusted by humans. When Hayori talked with Zohei and accepted to let his grandson into their house to observe them for a year, she also made him a request. They were going to spend a year to see if he was worthy of their approval, but in the 3 days he managed to do something quite similar to that. And that's why they decided to tell him now that he is a candidate husband for Boten. This surprise makes Boten quite embarrassed while trying to make Hyoma believe that it is all a joke. But the truth is that this isn't the first time that the six Tsukumagami try and find a husband for her. The six Tsukumagami are a part of a single set of bridal vessels, which makes it make sense that this is their one wish. Even though Hyoma was pretty calm during that situation, after he left he got shy and nervous. Alone he called his grandfather to nag him about the arrangement made behind his back, but to no avail. Boten passes by Hyoma and apologizes for the trouble caused by her family, and without thinking, he tells her that it was indeed very annoying. This mindless statement makes sadness bloom in Boten's eyes, and as she leaves while maintaining a fake smile on her face, Kagami and Suzuri didn't like it, thinking he was too cold. While outside walking down the street, Boten gets cornered by a giant Tsukumagami, saved on time by Hyoma before the Tsukumagami could harm her. Nagi and Yu join the fight to protect their master, and the three of them get out of the situation successfully. Yu immediately runs to Boten to check on her, while Nagi stayed behind in order to thank Hyoma for saving Boten. After being convinced by Kagami and Suzuri to follow Boten and ending up saving her, he feels guilty about his words earlier and tries to explain what he meant to her, but accidentally he confesses that he has some sort of interest towards her. Boten is too sweet to not forgive Hyoma for what he has said, so she puts her bright kind smile on, and tells Hyoma that it seems that they have a troublesome family. After the altercation, the boy decided to reinforce the defense around Boten with powerful amulets. However, he was forced to withdraw them later as they even affected members of his own clan due to their overwhelming power. Meanwhile, Hyoma's grandfather and the most prominent members of his clan were summoned by Kai, a powerful spirit who maintained a truce with the hunters in exchange for certain accommodations. The reason for the summons was that Kai wanted to understand why a guardian eye was linked to the residents of a spirit clan. It turned out that Boten held great value, and both spirit and hunter organizations frowned upon the proximity of a guardian eye to something so precious. However, the spirits explained that Hyoma was not seeking Boten's power, and in fact he was unaware of what she harbored within her. Meanwhile, Hyoma was removing the talismans he had previously placed and found himself cornered by two high-level spirits who apparently were pursuing him for the same deductions as Kai. However, Hyoma proved to be quite skilled and experienced for his age, managing to trick them into giving them a quick hit, catching the spirits off guard. However, they turned out to be stronger than he had calculated, and when it seemed that he had defeated one and trapped the other, both had him on the ropes as one of them was immune to his sealing technique. After neutralizing him, they began to torture him to extract information. Until then, the boy had thought that the spirits were simply seeking the weaknesses of the clan that hunted their kind, believing the dispute could be due to territorial conflict. However, he was completely surprised when they asked if his presence in that place was related to the search for Botan's power. Understanding that this could trigger a war between factions, they inquired about the hunter's plans regarding the girl's power. Upon this revelation, Hayoma freed himself from his capture, as he had allowed himself to be caught to extract information from them. Now he would be the one interrogating them about what they had previously asked him. Just before subduing them, you intervened to halt the conflict, advising that they let them go, since they were some sort of detectives or bounty hunters with permits to stay in the human world. They lacked the right to take them along. Consequently, the individuals withdrew after having obtained the information they were seeking. In reality, Hayoma was completely unaware of the power that Botan harbor. Following these events, Hayoma came to the conclusion that something was amiss with the girl who shared her life with the spirits. Hayori holding hands with Hayoma seems like they are dating. You might be wondering what's going on here, but everything has an explanation, and it all goes back to half an hour ago. He would try to figure out what all this was about, what Botan was hiding, but this time he wanted to do things right. He ended up inviting the girl to a date to be alone and ask her what was going on. However, she panicked, thinking it was a romantic invitation, and ended up rejecting him. Fortunately, Hayori, the clan leader, invited him to a date to explain what was really happening. However, this date turned out to be nothing more than a kind of pursuit of Botan. While they did this, Hayori asked Hayoma to carefully observe the surroundings. In doing so, the boy discovered something terrifying. The gaze of hundreds of hidden spirits was fixed on her, something that according to Hayori the girl had been dealing with all her life. She explained that this was because, as he well knew, spirits needed to possess an object to materialize in the world of humans. However, one of them had been able to possess a human, and to his surprise, that human was Botan. Fortunately, the spirit remained dormant within her, but its power was what attracted hundreds of spirits. They were all forbidden to approach her, even the hunters, because if that power fell into the hands of a faction, the balance would be lost. This was the reason why the other factions were furious that Hayoma approached them so closely. Moreover, that was the cause of the girl apparently always being alone, as her demonic aura repelled humans, of course, until they were assigned to protect her. Upon learning this, Hayoma, unlike the rest of the humans who knew, was not terrified. Rather, he decided to protect Botan, even more knowing the danger she faced. Furthermore, this confirmed to him that the clan spirits were not evil. In fact, they represented for Botan what his siblings had once been for him, and he would not allow the girl to be left alone. It's been quite a while, and the city now appears covered in white, with the cold making its presence known. However, the most noteworthy aspect is the significant improvement in the relationship between Hayoma and the clan. Although, as is often the case, when things seem to be going well, something unexpected always arises. Algi, the mercenary who had previously crossed paths with Hayoma, becomes an unexpected ally. After being hired by one of the Botan spirits, he reveals crucial information. Three hunter clans have their sights set on Botan. They are terrified of the power she possesses and believe it's best to end her life before the spirit fully awakens. On the other hand, Hayoma receives a summons from one of the largest clans in Kyoto City, to which he has moved. They request detailed reports of his hunting missions in the area. His grandfather warns him about Katamori, the leader of the clan, suggesting that he might be a wolf in sheep's clothing. Despite the warnings, Hayoma has no choice but to meet with the leader. The meeting with Katamori is intriguing, although Hayoma's grandfather had cautioned him. The leader appears friendly, even offering a demonstration of how his guardians under his command use seals to eliminate spirits. The situation becomes even more complex, plunging Hayoma into a scenario where alliances and appearances can be as deceptive as the spiritual world itself. As they conversed, the individual imposed two conditions for Hayoma to continue working in the area. The first was to provide detailed reports of all his missions, and the second, more impactful, involved eliminating Botan. According to him, the girl posed a danger, as losing control of her power could unleash a disaster in the human world. Despite the clan's previous attempts to get rid of her, the spirits of her clan always protected her. However, since Hayoma was living among them, they offered him the opportunity to accomplish the mission more easily. But Hayoma, without hesitation, firmly refused, defying the threats of the elder and warning him not to dare touch Botan or her family. Despite the staunch refusal, the elder was not willing to accept a no as an answer. Faced with the possibility of forcibly controlling Hayoma's body to fulfill the mission, they launched a powerful attack. Hayoma not only managed to block it but also counterattacked, sending one of the elder's hunters flying and demonstrating that they had gravely underestimated his abilities. Those who thought he was just an apprentice were astonished to see his body marked by scars and discover abilities far beyond the ordinary. Despite the evidence, the elder continued to underestimate him, arguing that feats in his village did not compare to the level of power in that city, determined to prove the power gap. He released several spirits controlled by talismans. What he did not know was that this made things even easier for Hayoma, who by unleashing his true monstrous nature used his weapon to easily get rid of the spiritual puppets. Hayoma's fighting style caught the attention of Tsubaki, the elder's daughter, who decided not to participate in the battle. His only interest was observing the amazing skills of Hayoma, who after a long time enjoyed the thrill of unbridled combat. On the other hand, the clan members discovered, thanks to the boy's grandfather, that he had become a hunter at the tender age of 12, but the most astonishing thing was not that, it was that afterward he took care of the spirit of the tiles, which apparently was one of the most powerful in recent times. The boys were astonished at what someone thirsty for revenge could achieve. Meanwhile, Hayoma continued to dispose of the old man's puppets, who opted for a rather unfair tactic. He used an innocent spirit, the one Hayoma had met a short time ago, and that took him out of the game. Now he had to send a spirit to another world that was only being used. This pushed him to the limit, focusing only on dodging attacks. The old man on his part was sure that this would happen, discovering that the boy had spent time with spirits. He thought his heart had softened, and now he only hoped that the spirit would defeat him. The old man's idea was for him to let his guard down because he had to deal with someone he knew, but he didn't count on Hayoma having much experience in these matters. When it came to making extreme decisions, he ended up mercilessly attacking the spirit, although that was what they believed. In reality, he only used the attacks to remove the control seal placed on the woman. Of course, after doing it in just a couple of seconds, he got rid of the last hunter and cornered the old man, who had no choice but to surrender and allow Hayoma to patrol the area. It seems that Tsubaki was interested in the boy because she also met his siblings before they died and even gave him her phone number to keep in touch. After this whole incident, Hayoma took it upon himself to bring the spirit from before to the Nagatsuki house. At first, Boten had strange thoughts about what Hayoma had really been doing. But after resolving the misunderstanding, Boten and Hayoma escorted the woman to their city. Upon his return, Hayoma revealed to the girl that he already knew the truth about the spirit that resides within her. Of course, she didn't have to worry about that as long as he was a guardian eye. He would take care of protecting her. Also, he revealed the story of his past, of how he sought revenge for the loss of his siblings. By the way, the Nagatsuki family were increasingly convinced that Hayoma would be the perfect husband for young Boten. A group of spirits were wreaking havoc among the hunters of the ancient Taiju clan. Given this, the committee decided to send you and Hayoma as reinforcements, a duo who are like oil and water. As they headed to the location, you explained to Hayoma that the gang they would face was made up of spirits who had possessed torture objects and were too powerful. Apparently, several years ago, it took several organizations to stop them. This made Hayoma unable to hide her happiness. He was eager to devour spirits as he was tired of holding back from fighting with all his might. Upon reaching the rendezvous point, they were greeted by Tsubaki, who would also join the mission in addition to her. The two previous mercenaries were present to work on this mission, guiding them to the gang leader's lair. Although their role was merely to escort them there, they had no time to withdraw as they were ambushed by the three powerful leaders of the gang, each controlling objects that granted them extraordinary abilities. Tsubaki faced the fire-wielding one, while Hayoma focused on the saw-wielding leader, who was extremely powerful. He even managed to land a good hit on you without her being able to do anything to defend herself. Only Hayoma, thanks to his artifacts, was able to face him as an equal. Meanwhile, Tsubaki and the mercenaries faced off against their respective opponents without suffering any inconvenience. The leader of the saws, realizing that he could not defeat Hayoma, fused with his object, gaining an even more powerful transformation. This caused you and Hayoma to join forces to defeat this new threat. In reality, Hayoma only participated in the final blow due to his injuries. He took the opportunity presented by Yu's attack to put an end to the first spirit once and for all. Returning with Hayoma and this group united for this mission after dealing with the spirit, Tsubaki mentioned to him that she had met his brothers before. In fact, she used to admire them for the great combat skill they possessed, which is why she too was in pursuit of the specter that had possessed an umbrella. So she proposed him to join her clan, as there he could gather much more information to track down the whereabouts of this creature that had taken her brothers. Yu, who was listening to the conversation, thought it wasn't a good idea to accept, since Tsubaki's clan was known for using hunters as mere tools. However, he believed that thanks to the darkness within the boy, he would eventually accept. Fortunately, Hayama ended up rejecting the offer, as he wanted to continue in the spirit clan. Upon returning home, Yu asked the Hayama why he had rejected the offer, to which he replied that he was certain that if he took that path he would be consumed by evil, so he would follow his own path to fulfill his revenge. The next day, Hayori gathered the entire family to announce that they would celebrate with a sukiyaki dinner that night. Each member was given a preparation task, and Hayama and Boten were given the mission to find the electric grill, whose location was a mystery. The expectations were obvious, as this quest would serve as an excuse for Boten and Hayama to progress their relationship. Hayori even gave Boten a love plan to charm Hayama, by the way. The girl was very nervous about this, while the others continued with their tasks. Boten wondered if Hayama was also feeling uncomfortable with the situation, or if he was at least thinking about it. At one point, Hayama found the list that Hayori had given to Boten on the ground. Upon reading it, the boy coldly commented that he didn't need to worry about that. Surprised, Boten could not settle for that reaction and wanted to see the boy's true expression despite his attempts to avoid it. They both stumbled, and the boy finally admitted to blushing in the end. Neither of them could hide their feelings anymore, although they did not formalize the relationship either. As night fell, the group enjoyed drinks and a delicious meal. Once alone, he told her that the Nagatsuki family reminds him of his brothers, and told her that he has a great family. After that incident, several days passed, and Hayama received an invitation from a specialized hunting apparel store. Because hunters typically use protective clothing to avoid mortal injuries, unlike Hayama, who always fought in normal clothes and ended up battered, to prevent acquiring more scars, he decided to accept the invitation. Upon arriving at the location, he once again encountered Tsubaki, who secured his entry to that renowned store. After noticing in their previous battles that Hayama always fought without protection, by the way, Tsubaki finally met Boten, whom she considered her rival for Hayoma's love. But getting to the important part, once in the store, our young hero learned that the garments were created through the power of some spirits that manifested themselves in the form of fabric to be able to use them. He first had to form a contract. After earning their trust, the way Hayama proved himself worthy of wearing the spirit was by demonstrating how he could withstand large-scale impacts through his daily physical training. Something very different from the rest of the hunters, who relied entirely on their garments for defense. Thanks to this, Hayama gained the trust of the fabric, more precisely conveyed to the fabric that it was worthy of protecting him. As this unfolded, Tsubaki mentioned to Boten that she was very interested and that she should be very careful, as otherwise she would snatch him away. Leaving that aside, while Hayama was waiting for Boten outside the university while he finished some homework, he received an unexpected visitor, Kai, who wanted to know the abilities of the boy who lived with Boten's family and was eager to face him. As a workout to confront Zohei's grandson Itsuki, the girl who accompanied Kai created a sort of barrier to prevent anyone from interrupting the confrontation. Although Hayama immediately attempted to attack him, the power difference was overwhelming. This individual was so far the strongest spirit he had ever faced. Thanks to the armor he possessed, which granted him various abilities on this occasion, Hayama would have to use all his skills to survive despite deploying all his power to the fullest. Kai managed to corner him and moreover mocked him by asking if he believed he could defeat the specter that had been following him for years with such mediocre power. Obviously, this infuriated the lad. Now that he knew Kai had information about the specter that killed his siblings, he turned into a beast. Thanks to his skill, he managed to land a blow on Kai. However, that wasn't enough, as Kai neutralized Hayama once again. A few seconds later, the battle was interrupted by the clan spirits, who sensed the presence of this spirit in the vicinity. Although Kai wanted to confront them for fun, the clan spirits had captured his companion, and she told him that his time for amusement had come to an end by sealing Kai's power, thus bringing the battle to an end. The spirit wasn't there to defeat Hayama, but simply to assess his abilities. Before leaving, he inquired why Hayama wasn't using his true weapon, as the rings were not Hayoma's original weapon, rather he used them as a form of mourning for his siblings. Kai explained that this way he could never confront the specter that killed his siblings. For that he needed his true power. Additionally, Kai also remarked to the spirits that they were quite cruel in allowing Hayama to protect Boten, even though the umbrella had taken his siblings when it tried to seize the power hidden within her. The girl listening from a distance was stunned by the revelation. However, thanks to those words, Hayama decided to leave the clan for a few months to strengthen himself. He knew that at his current level he wouldn't be able to fulfill his revenge and held on to the idea of not using his weapon. Months later, the young man was able to reunite with Boten and explain to her that he didn't leave the clan because he believed she was responsible for what happened to his siblings. He knew that the only culprit was the evil specter that had killed his family. So he decided to stay by her side, protecting her. However, Boten responded that it would be best for him to stay away, as every time humans tried to approach, they ended up losing their lives, like his aunt, the only person he had ever loved. Despite this, Hayama insisted, assuring her that she had nothing to worry about. Under no circumstances was he going to stop taking care of her and staying by her side, at least not until he had completed his revenge. For now, he would continue to protect her. It has been 6 months since Hayama arrived at the premises, and Boten notices a pipe that reminded her of the moment when they had to clean the room for Hayoma's move so that he could live comfortably with them. While Boten was dusting, she found that pipe that belonged to her grandfather. In that moment, a strange hand appeared and her screams alerted everyone in the house, who rushed immediately to rescue her. Just as this hand launched an attack against the girl, Hayori appeared, who can manipulate fabrics and managed to create a protective shield. However, the demon persisted, preparing for a new attack. At that moment, Nagi, with his arms transformed into swords, cut the demon in half. Although the Tsukamagami was defeated, Nagi also inadvertently destroyed her grandfather's pipe in the process. Despite her apologies, Nagi feared that Boten would be angry, but surprisingly she wasn't. Boten expressed her gratitude to everyone for protecting her, and they all admired the girl, proud of the strong woman she had become. In the present, she was ready to go to university, while Hayama trained diligently with Tsubaki. Both of them had the mission to uncover the person responsible for the death of Hayoma's siblings. Meanwhile, the Nagatsuki family was devising a security plan to protect all humans during the Aoi Festival, one of Kyoto's most significant festivals that attracted a large crowd. As if that weren't enough, the three great Tsukamagami of Kyoto, known as the Court Trio, would also be present on the festival day. Boten was having a good time with her friend when suddenly Hayama appeared behind them, unintentionally startling them. He informed them that they had to take care of preparing dinner together. That night, at that moment, Hayama detected something suspicious in the area. While exploring the place, he discovered that a specter was hidden in one of the parade umbrellas. He informed his team, and just as he was about to intervene, the three great Tsukamagamis of Kyoto made their entrance. Fuki, the first of the trio, caused everyone present to lose consciousness with a kind of flute. The elderly Tsumibiki trapped the demon with a thin thread, and Suzumi launched an attack that easily sealed the demon. This left Hayama stunned, and he approached to express his gratitude and introduce himself. When he revealed his name, the three fighters pounced on him, as they had heard about him and were eager to get to know him. Suddenly, Hayori landed on top of our protagonist, knocking him down with a flying kick and reprimanding him for what happened with the Tsukamagami demon. As he looked up, he noticed the presence of the trio and understood that they had assisted Hayama. With the issue, Hayori instructed the boy to report to Mr. Katamori, but the transmitter wasn't working since he was out of the radio range. As he approached the street from the building, he noticed a strange umbrella that brought back memories of when his siblings invited him to witness a battle against a Tsukamagami. In that fateful encounter, they were ambushed by the demon that nullified the techniques of the Guardian Eyes, and he watched helplessly as his siblings were ruthlessly defeated. Upon closer inspection of the umbrella on the sidewalk, a demon with a feminine figure revealed itself before him, watching him with a sinister gaze. On the second day of the festival, the trio celebrated their reunion with a small performance for the attending audience, including Hayama, who was watching them. Kagami appeared and reminded Hayama that he had promised to spend the day together. Together, they decided to take a stroll in the park, dine at an Italian restaurant, and try on clothes. Hayama realized that he had never experienced such fun activities before. Until that moment, his life had been focused on training to combat the Tsukamagami. Kagami, determined to change that, took the initiative and wanted to show him how to have fun after. Spending a day filled with fun, they returned to the venue. Suddenly, an evil Tsukamagami appeared and Nagi was chasing it along with you. Hayama, eager to help, joined them to seal the demon. Kagami watched them with confidence, knowing that Boten would be well protected in the future. Once the concert was over, the trio, excluding Fuki, who was detained by the police on the way, headed to the Nagatsuki family estate. Tsumibiki and Suzumi were surprised to see Boten and began asking her questions about the music that young people listen to, as they were looking for a new style. Meanwhile, Hayama left the estate recalling what Nagi had told him about the instruments being noisy and only talking about music, something that Hayama found boring. On his way, he encountered some friends of Boten who forcefully took him to ask him questions. Fortunately, Boten, who saved him from the curious questions of the girls, appeared. Soon after, the Tsukumagami of Kyoto alongside the leaders of the Nagatsuki family addressed the main issue and expressed their discontent with the actions they accused them of violating the law they had imposed. As they questioned the motive behind insisting that these young people get married, they suspected that the true purpose was to trap the visitor residing within Boten. They recalled how in the past she lost control after her aunt's death, and since the girl was on the edge between good and evil. They believed they were using Hayama to help Boten find true happiness as a human and seal the demon within her. Given that Boten's family consisted of bridal items, they felt it was their duty to carry out the marriage. The old woman's sixth sense indicated that Hayama met all the requirements to be a good husband for Boten, but it warned that violating the rule would only bring chaos. Despite the warnings, Hayori asserted that if necessary they would fight to the end to carry out the plan. Suddenly, the Tsukumagamis of Kyoto began playing music, leaving the leaders of the Nagatsuki family bewildered. Fearing it was the prelude to an attack, however, the true intention of the Tsukumagami was to confirm that their suspicions were correct. The old woman assured that they would not oppose as long as no one interfered. With the trio revealing that the main reason for the meeting was to seek their help regarding Tsukumagami that had appeared in the city, it was evident that they were referring to the Tsukumagami that Hayama had seen earlier. In the following days, we see Boten and her friends at the university, all of them members of a university club. They asked Boten to invite Hayama to help them with a task that required the strength of a man, so the girl called the guy and he immediately agreed. Upon arriving at the university, Hayama was arrested by the security guards, who thought he was a criminal. After clearing up the misunderstanding with Boten and learning about what had happened, he was welcomed by Boten's friends. While Boten headed to class, the girls served him tea and started asking him questions about his relationship with Boten, making Hayama feel uncomfortable and prompting him to flee the place. This action angered Boten, and on the way her friends tried to explain that they just wanted to get to know the guy and were concerned about his happiness. Suddenly, Boten felt a strange sensation and sensed the presence of the umbrella demon. The girls were unaware of what was happening. Attempting to escape, they became trapped within the barrier created by the demon, transporting them to another dimension. At that moment, Kai warned Itsuki that he had sensed a familiar energy, the same one Hayama had also perceived. The demon tried to peer into Boten's inner self to free its master. Natsuki, seeking an exit from the dark barrier, appeared and attacked the demon without hesitation. Later, Boten's friends were captured with the intention of harming them to awaken the demon within. Fortunately, Hayama arrived in time to protect his girl as he had promised. With a powerful attack, he managed to inflict significant damage on the demon as the demon regenerated from the attack. It asked Hayama how he would manage to defend the three women. At that moment, Fuki, the young wielder of the powerful flute, appeared and declared that he would protect the girls. He assured Hayama not to worry about them. His sole focus should be on battling the demon. With a determined expression, the demon showed excitement about the upcoming fight, eager to avenge its siblings. After this, he instructed Boten to step aside. Although he was aware that the specter posed a threat, he still harbored doubts about whether this was the demon that had killed his siblings, as it bore no resemblance to the specter he remembered from his childhood. Subsequently, the enemy summoned their weapon and absorbed the barrier. This led Hayama to believe that the specter was attempting to escape, and he threatened to defeat it to protect humans. In an instant, she disappeared and reappeared behind him. When he tried to attack her, the enemy dodged his blow and observed him from a distance with contempt, speaking about his older siblings. This provocation enraged Hayama, who used numerous talismans and combined artifacts inherited from his siblings to forge a new weapon. However, his attack proved ineffective as the enemy easily dodged his moves. Then he headed towards Boten and launched an attack to show Hayama that he couldn't protect her as he had promised. Just as it seemed like it was the end for Boten, her family appeared to rescue her alongside the rest of the team from the Tsukumagami of Kyoto. The enemy observed them and began to attack as they closed in on the threat. Nagi wielded his sword with all his might, successfully impaling the enemy without pausing in their attacks. The group surrounded it, overwhelming the adversary. Suzuri delivered the final blow, crushing it to the ground. Meanwhile, Hayama was impressed by the power of the Nagatsuki family as he witnessed them protecting Boten. However, the enemy surprisingly vanished, submerging into the earth. Kagami, using her mirror ability, located the enemy just as it attempted to seize Boten. Hayori cut the demon's hand into two pieces and Hayama took the opportunity to launch a kick that sent it flying. The Tsukamagami of Kyoto and the Nagatsuki family joined the battle in an attempt to seal the specter. At the last moment, the enemy bid farewell to its master and smiled despite being defeated in the watchful gaze of everyone. The elderly Tsumibiki announced that she would keep the sealed object in the storage of the guardian eyes. She promised that later on they could inquire about the deaths of Hayama's siblings. In the meantime, all rules would be followed, and the old woman instructed the group to take a break for the rest of the day. Hayama was surprised by how easily the specter he had been searching for was defeated. Afterwards, Hayori thanked Hayama for protecting Boten, but he claimed that she was mistaken. In reality, it was they who protected her. He was only concerned with defeating the enemy. Sadness reflected on his face upon hearing this. Boten suddenly felt something in her body was amiss and her eyes began to glow. Hayori ordered everyone to quickly return to the Nagatsuki mansion. They ran back to the mansion and upon arriving home were met with the surprise that it had all been a trap. The mansion was in ruins, though their true target wasn't the mansion itself but the protective pillar of the place. Elder Kushige, given that there were likely stronger enemies and that their main target was Boten, they understood that the best place to protect her was Tsubaki's house. Later at the Katamori mansion, they discovered that Kushige was sealed in his own container. Then a girl explained that there were two ways to seal a Tsukamagami. She revealed that Kushige had sealed himself in the container due to an imminent threat of destruction. Furthermore, she mentioned his intention to repair the container, though she wasn't sure if he would return alive. Meanwhile, Boten was unconscious and her family was worried about her condition. After this, Taiju mentioned that they would have many problems now without Kushige, as he was responsible for feeding the barrier to protect the mansion and also preventing the demon inside Boten from manifesting. Now the best course of action would be to keep her confined, as her power would be uncontrollable. Tsubaki finally arrived with the news that Boten had awakened and everyone eagerly ran to the room to see her. At that moment, the girl learned about what had happened with Kushige. On the other hand, Tsubaki pulled Hayama aside to inquire about the specter they had been searching for. So diligently, Hayama confessed that he wasn't certain if it was the same Tsukamagami as before. Tsubaki gave Hayama the impression that she knew more about it, and she revealed that she had uncovered some information through her own investigations. Moreover, she requested to exchange information about the Tsukamagami, as he had witnessed what had transpired at that moment in seconds. Tsubaki's brothers appeared to scold the lad as they learned that he hadn't applied in the battle against the specter. After that, Hayama finally had a moment alone with Boten. She spoke to him about Kushige, expressing the feeling that he would soon awaken to take care of her again as he had always done. She expressed hope that he could see her dressed as a bride, as that had been his wish since he took care of her when she was very young. At that moment, Boten confessed that she was waiting for him because she was grateful for him, so he kept his promise to protect her. Thanks to him, she and her friends was safe. Her words makes Hayama very happy, and that motivated him to protect her. In the evening, while speaking on the phone with his grandfather and sharing the situation of what had happened, he advised him that it was time to use his own powers. Until then, Hayama had used the powers inherited from his siblings, but now, as he was not seeking revenge and his sole objective was to protect someone, it was the right time to seek and develop his own power. The next day, Tsubaki came to pick up Hayama and he asked to use his family's dojo to try to master his power. Once at the location, as he prepared for the training, he recalled all the instructions his siblings had taught him to be able to master that power. In his first attempt under the watchful gaze of the present ladies, he couldn't achieve it. Having used his brother's fragments for such a long time, he had lost the connection with his own. After the training, Taiju informed Boten and Hayama that they should stay at the center, as it would be very dangerous for the girl to go to the university without Kushige's protection. He also mentioned to Hayori about a mission for the Nagatsuki family. The Yakuma clan, one of the three major organizations, wanted to meet them in person to discuss whether Boten would continue under their protection. Hayori gathered the entire family to brief them on the situation. Since they couldn't decline the invitation, therefore they would have to figure out how to protect Boten. Suddenly, the court's musical trio appeared and offered to help. The only condition imposed by the Nagatsuki family was that this trio would have to protect her with their lives until all of this was resolved. The next morning, Boten reflected on the words of the Tsukamagami and felt terrified by the demonic presence within her body. She recalled the moment when she asked Taiju about the truth. The reason for the umbrella specter's actions was still unclear, but it all began when she was kidnapped by her relatives. To evade the tsukumagami that protected her after that her parents died in the accident and Boten declared not remembering what happened, next Taiju explained to her during that amnesic period that she was not human and had surrendered control of her body to the inner demon. After they came to her rescue, Taiju mentioned witnessing a curious light that day because the tsukumagami in her service saw a bright light emanating from Boten. Everyone bowed to her as if there had been a change of leadership within Boten. Tsubaki asked if that light was the reason why the paper umbrella activated. Taiju explained that they believed the light attracted all the tsukumagami that had remained hidden as if it were a beacon. However, he cannot assert with certainty that Boten is the cause of the problem. Boten was very worried in her room, but remembering Hayoma's promise brought her a little more relief. On the other hand, Hayoma was exercising, and as he contemplated how to keep Boten safe without the presence of the Nagatsuki family, suddenly upon arriving at the mansion he felt that something was watching him. Without a word he was attacked with a sword by Nagi, but he managed to defend himself thanks to the Katamori style, the defense of the cloth. In Nagi's second attempt, Hayoma used a smoke curtain to distract him. When Nagi was about to attack Hayoma, he responded with his sword, asking if that was how he thought he could defend Boten. Upon hearing those words, Hayoma with his new power cleaved Nagi's sword in two. It turned out that Nagi was trying to verify if Hayoma had managed to control his powers. After this confrontation, Hayoma promised Nagi to protect Boten until the end. At night, the Nagatsuki family bid farewell to Boten as they headed to a meeting with the Yakima family in Tokyo. Meanwhile, at Taiju offices, some members considered Boten a dangerous being and were willing to take action if necessary to seal her and protect Kyoto. Taiju responded that for the moment they were not going to take any measures. Furthermore, everyone was afraid of Boten's presence, although she seemed unaffected, offering to help with whatever was necessary. While she lived there, after this we see the Nagatsuki family a bit nervous about the meeting except for Kagami, who was excited about the trip. Hayori tries to reassure them as they still don't know how they will be received at the meeting. Suddenly a specter violently lunges at the vehicle. At the office, Boten can consistently receives visitors due to her hard work. She sorts out favors, accepts merchandise for sale, and as a token of appreciation her clients give her food. As Hayoma and Tsumibiki witnessed this scene, they discuss the next operation. Subsequently, Hayoma invites Boten to spend time at the dojo. At the top of a building, both Aiki and Aoji spy on the Shota team to observe their incredible techniques against the city's tsukumagami. However, it won't be easy as their numbers are not few. Resuming the journey to the meeting, Hao is traveling by car when the mysterious man with the umbrella unexpectedly attacks the Nagatsuki family's vehicle, causing significant damage. To further complicate matters, three more specters appeared to join the battle. They succeeded in snaring Boten's family in a trap, leaving them helpless, and discovering that on the other side more members of these specters have the intention of seizing Boten. Meanwhile, at the dojo, Hayoma and Boten await updates about their ally's journey and talk about how crucial the team is for both of them. Matsu informs Taiju Katamori that the tsukumagami aren't putting up much resistance, which seems rather odd. After considering it for a moment, it occurs to them that these tsukumagami might not have been sent to attack but to set a trap and distract them. Both the Shota team and Taiju counter formidable opponents. Hayoma discover that the bureau is collaborating with the paper umbrellas, and Hayoma and Boten are attacked by one of its members. The enemies propose to hand over Boten without the need to fight, leaving them pensive. While the Shota team receives additional help, Taiju decides to protect Boten despite all the troubles she brought into their lives. Collectively, they all choose to risk their lives and protect Boten. Refusing to hand Boten over to the villains wasn't a response Suzumi could easily accept. However, Taiju has something in his favor. Suzumi and the others don't know Boten's exact location. Faced with an imminent defeat, Taiju has an ace up his sleeve, an impenetrable protective force. The team discovers that the previously defeated tsukumagami are now puppets controlled by Fuki through a flute. The fight is sure to be tough for both sides. Both Boten and Hayoma remain in trouble as they are now under the powerful grip of Tsumibiki, who uses all their potential to defeat both. Anticipating the annoying power-up, Hayoma asks Boten to cover her ears to withstand the noise emitted by Tsumibiki. After a distraction, Hayoma is injured and hurriedly tries to escape that place with his companion. Although Hayoma covered Boten, it didn't prevent them from having to counter Tsumibiki and company's constant attacks. Even though it seems like an unfair fight, Hayoma manages to make a giant rock fall on Shur. Although Hayoma try to escape, Tsumibiki does the impossible to restrain them. Even the unexpected occurs. Tsumibiki destroys the massive rock, revealing her true power. Despite Hyoma suffering severe injuries, he still refuses to hand over Boten. Tsumibiki attacks Hyoma again with a different power that could potentially kill him. Boten briefly considers handing herself over so that her companion may live, but suddenly remembers the promise Hyoma made to her. When it seems all is lost and Shigure attempts to kill Hyoma, he defends himself and cuts off her hand. At that crucial moment where the victory or defeat of both sides is defined, a key character appears in the scene. Tsubaki Katamori. The battle between the Shota team and the enemies has commenced, and they do their best to eliminate the puppets. Despite their efforts, Fuki revives the injured puppets, regenerating their missing parts. The team faces a significant challenge because to fully defeat the puppets, they must first defeat Fuki. If they don't do so quickly, the sound emitted by the flute could hypnotize them. Fortunately, the team receives help from a special squad. Meanwhile, Taiju Katamori does everything possible to defend himself from the powerful Suzumi thanks to his protective talismans. A giant monster now traps Suzumi, and a victorious Taiju is found outside the building, one powerful enemy down. Tsubaki Katamori arrives to defeat Hyoma and Boten's enemies. She begins analyzing Shigure and her true origin, while Tsubaki suggests to Hyoma to take a defensive stance. She launches an offensive attack directly at Tsumibiki. Even Shigure tries to attack Boten, but Tsubaki's power extends and prevents this incident. She is intoxicated by power and wants to claim the prize of defeating these two opponents using multiple weapons and powers. While wounded, Tsumibiki recalls that during the war between the Kyoto Seinomi and the Shogun, Tsubaki Katamori defeated her enemies while laughing with excitement. This is why Tsumibiki avoids a confrontation with this powerful opponent and decides to fight Hyoma instead. She notices that he is in shock since they are now enemies. She explains to him that he needs to uncover what Boten carries inside her, because she is the key to open the door that separates the living from the dead. She explains that the ambition of the Tsukamagami is to be heard by humans. Of course, Hyoma wants to avoid this crazy mission, so he decides to fight against Tsumibiki. Meanwhile, Suzumi manages to escape from where Taiju trapped him and battles against the snake spell summoned by the elder. Despite exploding this snake, the spell remains active, attacking Suzumi. Hyoma tries to defend himself with his weapon against Tsumibiki, and Tsubaki continues to fight against Shigure with a significant advantage, but suddenly a voice stops the battle. Without Hyoma and Boten expecting it, the whole gang gathers, leaving the others in shock. After Fuki begins a new melody, she summons new characters who are bearers of umbrellas. Before the fight begins, Hyoma warns Boten to flee the scene to save herself. Tsubaki senses Hyoma's determination to defend against these new enemies and feels excitement at having such dangerous rivals to defeat. As the battle commences, they have to dodge enemy attacks. Kagurashi is the first to attack, unleashing strange powers that emerge from the ground. Other enemies like Suzumi and Fubuki join forces to confront Hyoma and Tsubaki. Both are struck but continue forward regardless of the damage they receive. Meanwhile, from a distance, Tenjutsu analyzes the battle, his eyes fixed on Boten. Boten wants to try to run and escape as Hyoma ordered, but she realizes she can't because she's under Fuki's powers. Worse still, Shigure appears behind her, bringing back memories. A memory that traumatized her, as during a car trip she and her protector were attacked by several Tsukamagami, causing an accident. Seeing this pattern repeat and potentially losing those who protected her again, the true power of Boten slowly emerges. Umi is taken aback by the aftermath of the battle against Fuki puppets. She asks Matsu where Fuki went, and he responds that Fuki suddenly escaped. They both notice that the Tsukamagami who aided them previously in the fight are behaving strangely. Now the enemies kneel as Boten's true power gradually manifests. Leaving her looking possessed, her face has changed and she's surrounded by a dark aura. Boten's godlike power prevents her enemies from moving. She approaches Suzumi and demands that he stands up. Upon noticing Suzumi's injury, she decides to eliminate him, shocking everyone. The enemies, including Tsubaki, are taken aback by the individuality of this godlike entity, someone they cannot control. Hyoma demands this god to return Boten. Something within her shifts, weakening her power and aura. She, or rather the god residing within her, tries to resist, but Hyoma's words and memories are stronger. Hyoma embraces her and slowly sheds her godlike persona while yelling at the enemies. A power is unleashed from the box that was under surveillance. Thanks to Hyoma's efforts, Boten returns to normal and all enemies rush towards Hyoma, who obstructs the villain's desires. The team emerges from Taiju Umbrella, who had trapped them. Bad luck for the villains who were about to harm Hyoma. Smile returns to Botan's face upon seeing her companions rescue them. Nagi and the others anticipate the enemy's attacks, dodging them to hold Hayoma in their arms, while others exchange pleasantries. Hayori orders Hayoma to rest as he is in critical condition. Nagi acknowledges him as a true man for fulfilling his promise. The confrontation is imminent. Tenjutsu makes his appearance in front of them and leaves them in shock after saying the following: "It seems Hayoma's older brother didn't die as he thought, and now he's become the one of strongest Tsukumagami." Hayoma is confused. He remains determined to protect Boden. Tsumibiki attacks again. Hayori threatens her, demanding that after defeating her she explains her betrayal to the team. Despite this, Tsumibiki is determined to fight. Both sides begin to argue, and it's Nagi who loses patience and initiates this bloody battle. Later, Tsumibiki and Fuki reveal their final forms. Tsumibiki announces her special attack but is briefly halted by Hayori. Fuki also attempts to launch an attack, but it's swiftly reflected by a mirror, a power of Kagami. Nagi cleverly leaps and lands a lethal blow on Tsumibiki, leaving him in agony. However, he manages to recompose himself, fueled by rage. At one point, Fuki shoots one of his powers at Suzuri, temporarily incapacitating him. Tsumibiki, facing potential defeat, unleashes another new power which even stuns their own allies. This immense power exerts great pressure on the heroes, giving Fuki the advantage to deliver the final blow. Despite the overwhelming despair, Fuki's strike does not harm the allies thanks to Kushige's intervention in this fight. Kushige easily strips Tsumibiki of their powers, thus freeing them from another troublesome trap. Hayori confronts her enemies with great determination alongside her team's power, vowing to put up a tough fight. Both Tsumibiki and Fuki are exhilarated by the battle, and both sides clash again. This time both sides utilize their abilities to the fullest, but the allies coordinate their forces to deliver a decisive blow to the enemy. Other Tsukumagamis appear on the battlefield. Shigure vows to take Boten away despite being injured. Tsubaki wants to keep fighting, longing to have those in front of her in her possession. Hayoma does the same to defeat his nemesis. Both heroes and villains advance to attack simultaneously. Hayoma tries to land a precise blow but ends up wounded. His enemy has no trouble defending and dodging attacks. At that moment, Hayoma realizes that his enemy is the one who murdered his brother and sister. With determination and a thirst for blood, he wants to defeat the one who now wears his brother's skin. Tenjutsu tells him that those who led to his siblings' deaths were his grandfather and Hayoma himself, leading him to react violently. Tenjutsu brings back memories of his childhood when he fought against his elder brother. Seeing Hayoma distracted by this memory, Tenjutsu begins to attack him continuously. Meanwhile, the other villains try to abduct Boten, but Yu evades the attacks. Nagi fiercely attacks Shigure while Tsubaki faces an enemy hitting him in the face and rendering him unable to fight. The battle between Hayoma and Tenjutsu becomes increasingly difficult because constant memories of his brother, whom he never managed to defeat, keep surfacing. The young man tries to confront his enemy, who has now unleashed his true power. He attempts to stand up, but it's in vain. He's too wounded, while his enemy insults him to demoralize him. His allies give him enough reasons to keep fighting, and each expresses their positive viewpoint, while simultaneously trying to confront the villains. Ultimately, it's Boten's cry that gets Hayoma back on his feet. The reasons for his struggle are clear: to vow to destroy the malevolent Tsukumagami and also to defend Boten. This reflection reveals their true power. Combining his two weapons, Hayoma unleashes an incredible power so potent that his allies must step away from the fight as a precaution. Releasing this immense power, he utters the technique called Kanato Gate Opening. He hurls it towards Tenjutsu, who tries to stop it, but it explodes in his face. Everything around is destroyed, including half of Tenjutsu's body, although he regenerates effortlessly. Fortunately, Taiju Katamori and the rest of the team joined the battle, significantly easing the fight. Tenjutsu sees winning that battle as impossible, so he decides to escape, threatening to take Baten with him someday before vanishing along with his allies, using the umbrella for transportation. With no additional threats, Hayoma collapses. Boten rushes to check on his health, but he explains that he's just tired and she shouldn't worry. Taiju Katamori commends the team for their hard work, while the others casually discuss how they'll return home. Hayori keeps Zohei informed about the betrayal and the enemy who attempted to capture Boten. She also asks Zohei if he was aware that Tenjutsu wore Hayoma's brother's skin, to which Zohei confirms his knowledge, explaining his desire to keep his grandson away. After a long rest, Hayoma wakes up and notices Boten also in the room waiting for him to awaken after the boy compliments her. Both feel embarrassed. Hayoma feels even more embarrassed upon realizing they weren't alone. Taiju and Tsubaki are also present. Taiju invites him to the traditional gathering often celebrated after a great fight. At the gathering, the entire team is present. They acclaim Kushige, naming him the star, leaving Hayama surprised since he participated for only a few minutes. At one point, everyone present demonstrates loyalty towards Boten, leaving her speechless. Hayama reflects on his vendetta against the paper umbrellas and realizes there was something bigger than his hatred for these enemies. He looks around and sees his friends safe and sound, fixing his gaze on Boten, his reason to protect. Kushige thanks Hayama for defending his mistress, startling the young man upon discovering that Kushige can speak. This signifies good fortune for everyone for the new year. Boten's friends tried to investigate what she was up to all that time, even speculating that she might be getting married. However, she can't reveal the truth, feeling embarrassed as they leave the place. They ask Boten why she doesn't have an umbrella since it's raining. At the same time, Hayama arrives to bring her an umbrella as Kagami mentioned she forgot it. This gesture further embarrasses Boten in front of her friends. Both walk in the rain and Boten affectionately shares the umbrella with Hayama, but instantly realizes that it's something couples do, feeling embarrassed again. They both witness a wedding and Hayama suggests that Boten would look very nice in a wedding dress, which makes her even more uncomfortable. The family observing from atop of roof sees them in this situation and encourages them to finally become a couple, teasing Hayama for being so reserved. Soon the sun comes out and it's Boten who takes the first step. She suggests to Hayama that they approach the wedding holding hands to get a closer look. Both of them run hand in hand laughing.